it's a rebuy. The vlog. We are here in Monte Carlo and we're gonna start with a big one with Triton, which is the 250k Invitational. We just finished the seed draw and the cards are gonna be in the air in 10-15 minutes. My table is, well, full of pros. What can I say? It's the day one where the pros play against each other, so I'm ready to play. The people who don't know, I have been a resident in Monte Carlo since 2007, so 16 years, so it's my home turf here. Very happy that Triton finally made it here. One of the best destinations to play poker. Here we are on a break. We played four levels so far. The first two levels, not much really happened from my part. I was even, and last two levels, unfortunately, I lost a couple big pots. Both were four bets pre-flop, which means that there were a lot of money in, and I had both losers. I had jacks in one hand, and board ran bad. Kim came, and I just decided to let my hand go. And another hand was a bit more unfortunate. I three bet Chris Brewer about fourth time of the day. And this time he decided to four bet me out of position. I had pocket kings and I just called and ace flopped. He ended up having ace 10 and I lost some chips over the, in that hand. So I'm down to 200,000 from starting 300,000 chips. So I think this is the worst start I've had in these invitational tournaments where we played the first day with pros only. So yeah, lost 33% of my stack and I have a lot of work to do now. So hopefully those big hands, I mean, those were the two biggest hands I've had all day, jacks and kings, and both lost. And let's see, there's a lot of play obviously left. And but yeah, not the ideal start for this tournament. We're just finishing a dinner break. A lot of things happened in the last few levels. So I won a big pot with ace-jack. I three-bet Chris Brewer and he called with king-10. Flop game, ace-queen-jack. So he flopped the nut straight, I flopped aces up. All the money went in on the flop, I hit an ace on the river, double up. So I have 420k now. Had a lot of hands today, had many times jacks today, but the jacks been losing a lot. But that was one big one, so we're back in the game and second TV table right now. So four more levels left with the pros today and yeah, looking better now. It's last break today. I have pretty much the starting stack. Had a lot of hands today to play, just a lot of big hands like ace kings, ace queens, ace jacks, pocket tens, pocket queens, pocket kings, pocket jacks. And I have the same as I started with. So basically, I won one big pot today with that ace jack where I got lucky on the river to win that. So overall, I'm pretty frustrated the way the day has been going. And you know, poker is like, you never know how things are gonna work out. Like, you might start every hand with the best hand and you don't win any of those hands. I've had more good starting hands that I have in my memory, like for years. I've had so many big hands, like nines, tens, jacks, jacks, kings, ace kings, all day long, like especially the last 4 hours. But they just don't find a way home. I was just recently playing very big gas games in Vegas, and I arrived 2 days ago to Monaco. So you never know how jet lag is, for example, treating you. And today I've been really struggling to keep my energy, and just played last two levels on the second televised table, and I was barely able to keep my eyes open. So last two levels coming, and I'm gonna try to kind of regain my focus and fight. Day one is finished in the 200K Invitational. I end up having pretty bad day at the end of the day. I finished with 76,000 with chips. We started with 300,000, and was pretty tough day. One of the toughest days I've experienced with tournament poker myself. First four levels, I still had pretty decent energy levels, and I was playing pretty good poker, and I end up having 420,000 chips after those levels, but then I crashed so hard with my jet lag, and sometimes jet lag can hit me so hard that it's hard to understand. And today I was pretty much fighting to stay awake on the table for like 4 or 5 hours of play, and I couldn't make it here earlier and prepare myself better. But also I was counting that when I play big tournaments like this, that normally there's some adrenaline that kicks in with me when you play for big money like this, and today that didn't happen either. After all these hands kind of going result wise not my way, I got lucky in one big hand with ace jack, making that full house on the river against straight, and that's where I doubled up. But after all those hands, like every hand kind of find a way to lose, then I end up making a little bit poorly executed bluff at the end of the day, which cost me 125,000 chips. Rebuy time is finished in this tournament, so I'm really on the bottom of the list of chips. And once you have like this kind of stack, like 12 big blinds or so on, 10 big blinds, it doesn't really matter. You have pros, businessmen, there's not much you can do magic with little chips. So I will definitely need some cards, luck, get myself back to having 30 big blinds and so on, and we can play. And like you can see now, I'm wide awake. It's 1 a.m. we finished playing. Now I would be good for me to play all night, no problem. Yeah, what can I do? It's part of poker when you play around the world. And let's see tomorrow. I mean, I'm not giving up. I'll give it all. And there's still pretty good chance, I would say. I mean, I could be out. It could be worse. Could be better, could be worse. Let's go to sleep and see what happens tomorrow. It's day two in the 200K Invitational. Good news is that I'm still in. Bad news that I don't have so many chips, but you know, I started on the very bottom today with 76K, and I have now 126. Basically three hands that I played, which were kind of interesting. I had nines early on the big blind, and I managed to shove in on top of a raise, and I got called with deuces, so very good raise for me, 80-20 favorite. Won that one and basically managed to get to 200K on that point. And then came one hand that I had 5-4 on the big blind, and there was a raise and a call, and I decided to play my hand, and I got kind of stuck with that. I flopped a middle pair, deuce, 4-7. Apparently I had the best hand on the flop, and I got outdrawn on a turn when the ace came, and Federer holds at ace deuce, and end up making a full house on the river, deuce pair the river. I got stuck on a turn also because I had a gut shot, and the bet was so small that I was forced to call there against two players. Just, you know, having a four as an out and a gut shot. So that kind of cost me, and you know, it put me down to 60K. And the very next hand I had small blind against big blind, pocket threes, you know, six big blinds against Federer. I shoved all in, he called, and he had two overcards, and I made quad fours, cut quad threes. So So that's where I'm now, with 126. There's 73 entries and 36 players left, so we lost 50% of the field so far, and today's an important day, obviously, and the field is looking pretty nice. I mean, today we combined all the businessmen with the pros, so this is gonna be a complete redraw. I'm just gonna take a little break, go to my room, and we'll be back soon. No, really? Oh, I got Jack.
Greenwood suited. That's one good. Gapper. Enough to give Patrik a spin. Picture of the fin hanging in the balance in a 264K pot, and he finds a 9, but unfortunately Greenwood finds a 10. So Patrik.
What is a good card?
Nine. The Jack Red 9 for the time being, but
Queen's a good call, actually.
Maybe there's a sweat card in his future.
Yeah, we want an ace and a king.
I was saying with Pat.
Yeah. 6. Not sweaty at all. Now it's 5 outs once for the Monaco resident. And that is a wonderful
good game. Here we are on the rail. Unfortunately, just busted from the 200K. So we had that 30-minute break and the redraw. And I had a pretty good draw, actually, because I got drawn into a small blind, which is a good draw. You get so many free hands and so on. But unfortunately, the first hand, it got folded to me. I had Jack 9, 10 big blinds, shove all in. Got called with Queen 10, and I lost the race. End up making actually a second highest pair with 9, but the 10 came also. So here we are. There's no regret really how I played today. I think I made only good decisions. Yesterday I have some regret from some hands. So there's always, you know, when you play poker, it's not a perfect game. Meant to play perfectly, nobody can do that, and you should not demand that from yourself. So now it's time to take rest, study a little bit tournament poker, which I need to do. I need to do always working on my game. So yeah, it's not the worst thing to go out this early to get this kind of break. Many times you end up playing all day, morning to night, and you're very tired after 4 or 5 days of play, and then you're gonna pay the price. So I don't feel anyhow upset today, because there's nothing I would really change the way I played. This main event today, buying 125,000, and day one, obviously. I played 2.5 levels so far, and I've had a kind of a quiet table with slow play, so not much table talk, and the pace of play has been slow, so not too much has happened so far. Still, my chips went kind of up and down. I started with 250K, like everyone, and now I have 320, but I was already down at 200, because I lost a little bit unlucky flip. If you can call it a flip, I raced with ace queen from the cutoff and the small blind shoved for 59,000 with ace four, and I called and the four came, so I lost a pretty decent pot, still like more than half a starting stack. So hopefully those bad beats are on their way, like early on now, so we don't have to face them later. Table is okay for you know, day one. I don't really have any like big businessmen on my table. It looks like all pros, but usually I do better in these kind of tables in general. I have good experiences playing against the toughest players. So anyways, we have a break now, 52 minutes. I'm gonna go to my room to rest and trying to keep it up, what's going on. I have good energy levels today. I feel like my jet lag is finally over, and it's a long way, long tournament, 3 days. So we'll see what's gonna happen. Here we are outside of Triton. I busted my first bullet in the main event. Not much I can really do with my hand. Nick Petrangelo, he opened early position. I had ace king, I had 3 bets. He 4 bets. I had 2 options, call or shove. decided to shove my 85 big blinds. Easy call for him for kings. He won the hand. Even if I decided to just call his four bet, all the money would have gone in easily. King flopped, came king 8-5, so cannot see the way that I could possibly not go broke with this hand. So bad luck, unfortunate hands, you know, these things happen all the time. Right now, just catching some fresh air and taking a break. But yeah, the main event is looking good. We have 100 entries so far, so it's gonna be a nice price pool, and maybe it's just a better strategy to take some rest, sleep, be more fresh tomorrow, because there's not much left today. That might just be a better strategy overall.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a rebuy in the main.
New day, so I made a decision yesterday to not rebuy because we had like a 1.5 levels left, and yeah, today feeling good, so I had 25 big blinds to start, so it's a lot of plays still left. Good news is that I'm still in. We played four levels, but it's been quite a roller coaster. I lost half of my stack in the first hand I played today. Just blind versus blind. I had 9-10 offsuit. And flop came jack 8-5, rainbow. And I got check raised on the flop, and opponent bet the turn, and I had to continue. And I missed everything on that, and opponent went all in on the river, so I had 10 high folded. So it was looking at that point pretty bad, but then I was able to pick up a few times blinds. Then came a very nice hand where I doubled up from, I think I had 450,000 starting on the hand. I had king jack off on the big blind, and Chris Brewer raised from the early position, and Nick Petrangelo called from late position. Flop came again jack high, I think it was jack 8-5 or jack 8, jack 8-5 pretty much, with two diamonds. Flop went check, check, check. I had king jack, no diamond. Turn came a six, third diamond. I decided to bet a half a pot. Chris Brewer called behind me, and Nick folded. And the river came another six, no diamond, because the six was a diamond, so I paired the board. I put him on that spot that he would most likely have a flush draw with the ace high flush draw, and I decided to check, and he went all in, like naturally, like he decides to take a bluff line with his hand. I thought about it for a while. I looked at him and decided to call. It was kind of an easy call since I decided to play my hand in this way. So that was a nice double up. Had almost 900K after that hand, but since then I haven't really had many winning hands, and I'm down to around 500K now. So, but the good news is that we are 35 players left from 135, so 12 from the money. Very happy how I played today. Also feeling great, best day I felt so far. The next thing is really to make the money and go from there.
Yikes.
This could be
when the dinner breaks.
Time to start engraving Patrik Antonius' tombstone in the main. Back to Mateos. Does he want to play it as a trap and invite Webster in behind him? Or would he prefer to just 4-bet under the assumption that Patrik doesn't have a lot of 3-bet folds off of this stack at this size?
Yeah, both Lim and Antonius have about 30 big blinds. So you see Mateos making that call because it did look like a prime squeeze spot as well for Patrik, given the call in between. And so Mateos gonna go the trappy route, feeling like Antonius will have some 3-bet folds.
We've seen aces be very trappy on the day. Vogel saying, giving us the first taste of that. Some coordination and texture here. Jack 8-7, two hearts, neither player with a heart in hand. Oh, and he's going to play it as a check jam. Mateos, quick to call. And yeah, everybody knows that there is really nothing more you can do than be along for the ride to disaster when it's kings against aces. Two outs once. Not there.
Yeah. Yeah, Patrik.
And that's going to do it for Antonius.
I busted 30th, 7 from the money. Today was a pretty good day in every way. Like I was playing my best, basically, like made all the right decisions today. Cards were going well also. I managed to win one hand before busting. I had ace-10. Ace-10 all-in against ace-8. And my ace-10 held there, and I got my chips a little over 700,000. And then we got moved to the TV table, and it didn't take more than one round until came a hand where I got dealt kings against aces. So very typical thing that you go out no matter how many chips you have, and it wasn't meant to be this time. It kind of sucks to run bad in the big ones. It's been a lot of big ones that I've been in very good positions, and this field that was left, these 30 players, this was looking really good. There's a lot of businessmen left, and especially when I started to really be in my zone, I was feeling good. It felt like today was gonna go far, but anyways, now the two largest tournaments are done. I used 3 bullets, one in the 200K and 2 in the main event, and there's a 100K tournament tomorrow, which I'll play. Then the tournaments are gonna go a little bit down, 50Ks and 75Ks and 30Ks and so on. So there's still a lot of poker left to play. All you can do is really just try your best to play and keep going on. There's always a next tournament and next day, and just keep your energy up and come and win the next one. Just busted from the 100K high roller, played on the TV table, and had a good start today. We started with 200K. Early in the tournament, I called with Queen Deuce of Spades on the big blind. Justin Bonomo opened with Ace 8 of Diamonds, and I flopped the full house game. Deuce, Deuce, Queen. Perfect flop for me, and it was an easy play for me. I check called the flop, check called the turn, and he shoved the river. He made a flush on the river and shoved the rest of the chips. So I was just calling all the way. So I got my chips all the way to like 360K, something like that. Anyways, I busted with the hand. I had 6-4 of spades on the big blind. Cheat week opened from under the gun, and the player who busted me, he called from the late position. Flop came Jack 8-5 with 2 spades. They were around 50,000 on the flop, and I checked. Chidwick checked, and the player who busted me, I'm sorry, I cannot remember his name right now. He bet half a pot, 25,000. So I flopped a gut shot with the flush draw. 6-4 spades, it was Jack 8-5 with Jack and 5 of spades. Decided to call, there was no reason for me to build a pot here and raise, and Chidwick went out. We continued to see a turn, which came a 6. So I paired my 6 now. I had a pair now with the gut shot with the flush draw. And now there was 100,000 in the pot. I checked, my opponent bet 85,000. This left me a decision that, what do I do here? I cannot fold my hand. I have too strong of a draw here. I have all the odds to call, to make 2 pair, to make trips, to make a straight, to make a flush. I went through my options quickly and came to a conclusion that he pretty much has few hands that beats me. He can have pocket 5s for set, he can have pocket 8s for set, he can have ace jack, king jack, queen jack, maybe 10 jack if he's betting that on the turn, and all the rest of the hands he has draws. He can have complete error obviously also if he's just bluffing, or he can have a straight draw or larger flush draw or so on. So So I decided to shove the rest of my chips here. After the race, I had about 200,000 more. So basically, he's folding if he has all the air. If he's on a draw, I have a best hand. It's a good situation in this case. But if he has my beat, I still should have a lot of outs here. So it's kind of a complex spot in this way. But unfortunately, he called right away when I shoved, and he had one of the worst hands for me to see, which was set of eights here. So that just left me only a gut shot and the flush draw to hit the river, and I missed the river. I'm out. Here we are. These are those important big hands. You know, we were playing pot size for four times the starting stack. So whoever won this pot is in a great position right now. Unfortunately, I did not make it, and gonna rebuy later. 45-minute dinner break now. I'm going to eat, and gonna jump into the action after that. So. I'm here with Danny Tang. He's been quite a crusher for a while in the poker world, but some of us who still don't know him, this is your chance to get to know him. So Danny has 21 million in tournament winnings, and so maybe you could tell us that what got you to poker and how long you've been playing high stakes.
What got me to poker? I just basically started playing after I graduated from Manchester University. I was not very good academically. Wasn't interested in studying. Went to the casino, poker found me, I found poker, started playing, went professional, and started playing high stakes maybe 2018, 2019. Yeah, got my first bracelet 2019 in the World Series. First time playing Triton, got second in the main event, and just kind of never looked back.
Quite a lot of winnings for this sort of period of time. Any other hobbies outside of poker?
It might not look like it, but I'm actually really into sports. I play a lot of sports like football, basketball. I'm into MMA. Any sport, I'll kind of dip my toes in and have a go, you know?
I think most of us who play poker, we have a heart for sports and our competitiveness.
For sure.
You have a lot of tournament wins. Do you play much cash at all?
I go through periods. Like, some of the cash games that we played are just very exclusive, and sometimes a short deck. Depends on, like, you know, if some VIPs or businessmen wants to play, they will give us a call and we'll play. Depends on where it is. Sometimes in Macau, sometimes in Korea, sometimes in Manila, sometimes in Hong Kong, sometimes on a plane, sometimes on a yacht, you know. So but I don't just grind cash game, you know, day and day. I don't really enjoy it, but if there's some exclusive cash game and they give us a call, we're there, you know.
Yeah, so tournament is your main thing
for sure.
How is the Monaco Triton series going for you?
It's been pretty good. No trophies, but I've cashed for near enough 2 million, maybe over 2 million US here. So it's been pretty good trip.
Yeah, it's been nice at it. The winnings.
Yeah, I like to, you know, cap it off with a trophy though. There's still a couple of events, you know.
Yeah, you have two Triton titles so far?
No, four.
You have four?
I have four Triton titles.
My bad. I should have known.
No.
Sorry for my mistake. Well, thanks for your time and good luck.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Patrik. Here we are outside. I just busted my second bullet in the 100K, so feeling pretty shitty. Honestly, I can say that. I won a few hands or one nice hand before, so I went from 200K to 250K in chips, and then the hand where I went out was a hand that I have a little bit maybe regret. I could have decided to play it differently, but I had ace five of clubs. I raised from a very late position, the one before cutoff, and Elton, who was the chip leader of the table, he decided to three bet me from the button. And so I opened with to 21,000 and he made it 55,000. Action folded to me. I had 250K chips, so I decided to move all in with my hand. He had nines and he called. It's pretty easy call with nines. Nobody's folding that for this race. So, and the board ran quite fucked again. Like, I hit an ace on the turn to make me the best hand, and he revered a fourth heart actually to make the flush. So he sent me to the rail and here we are. So far the series is not going the way I planned. I've had a pretty bad jet lag for the first 2-3 days. Lost one bullet, one bind in the invitational 200,000. Used two binds in the 125,000 main event and two in the 100K. So we are down 600K or more in the series. So it's always frustrating when you go a few binds without any cashes. So, but yeah, this is the life of a high stakes poker player. It's not always just all wins every day, and have to get your mind cleared up again and come back strong tomorrow. Here we are with the fellow tennis players, or should I say poker players? Poker players, of course. Bruno Walkman has very high level on tennis. He came to hit for a while. This is what always happens. After I don't hit for 1 year, so blister starts to open until you build a rough skill. So I'm done for today, tired over the hours. But we had some very nice points.
Tell me more about yourself, like how long you played poker professionally, and when did you start to play these kind of super high rollers?
So I tried to play professional, tennis professional, till 2010, 2011. And then I ended up playing some poker with friends. And then I started to play poker professional in 2012. I changed career, played a lot of online MTTs. And then in 2018, 2019, I started to play high stakes online. And since 2021, I started to play high holders live tournaments.
Yeah, so you're more of a tournament player,
yeah,
instead of cash game player. I've noticed that there's been a massive amount of Brazilian poker players coming to play high rollers and online and so on. And what do you think is the reason why so many Brazilians have found a really high level on poker nowadays, and it seems like that you're here to stay for the high roller tournaments?
I think the community in Brazil is very big. Like everybody loves to play poker. We have a huge series in Brazil, Brazilian series of poker. I think everybody loves the game, you know, in Brazil. Yeah, yeah. We have a lot of teams, a lot of study groups. I think it's natural.
Yeah, and usually what happens is once certain players, they hit a high level and they start playing higher, you bring kind of others level up and they start believing that they can play against the best also. And but I noticed like you guys are really very professional players, like it's nice to see.
Because of the currency change, you know, if you win a little bit in online, you ended up winning a lot in Brazil because of the currency. Since I was tried to play professional tennis, I'm very competitive. I didn't want to stay like playing mid, small, just winning a bit. I always try to become my best.
I think we have a little bit advantage overall, like if you come from basically a professional sports background, that you take that.
Yeah,
you know how to compete, and you take those wins and losses and hard work with you to a poker, which is, yeah. And now it's amazing that we have the most amazing game. We can keep competing and kind of living like a professional sportsman.
It feels me, you know, because like the competition is always been in my blood.
Yeah,
because I started playing tennis when I was 8 and started competing when I was, I don't know, 9, 10. So I like this kind of stuff. The, you know, when you feel like you're gonna be in final table, you feel like a bit, I like that, you know?
Yeah, yeah, of course. I mean, it's so intense.
Yeah.
So many emotions, and yeah, like once you have that competitiveness, like it's really addicting. It's like it's just a way of living life that otherwise we would have to find other ways to,
yeah,
to
like
to test ourselves, and go out and perform. So
yeah,
so it's really nice to see you in these high rollers.
Thanks, Patrik.
All the best. And all the best to all the Brazilian players.
I came to play 40k Mystery Bounty, which started a few hours ago, and my first bullet did not last too long. I lost two pretty ridiculous hands, to be honest. Pretty bad luck. I had A7 of hearts on the big blind, and early position opened, and the button called, and I called. We saw a flop of Ace Queen 4, rainbow. I had a backdoor flush draw, and I checked. The original opener continued, betting around third of the pot, and the button called. I continued with my top pair ace. Turn fell an 7. So I made aces and sevens, pretty strong hand, and I still played it slow. I checked. The early position race opener continued on a turn with about 60% size, and the button decided to call. And at this point, I understand that the hand values are pretty strong here. What is left to bet for value, what is left to call. So I was definitely afraid of a set of fours or ace queen, or obviously set of queens. A7 I both block, so set of aces is very unlikely here. So pretty much yes, ace queen and set of fours, kind of those two hands that beats my hand. I called and we saw a river, which was 5, which was perfect blank. Doesn't feel anything really, nobody's gonna have deuce three in this hand. So anyways, river I checked still, and I still faced a bet for the same player who opened on this hand, and he chose a size again around 60% of the pot. Button folded, and I had an easy call. It's an automatic call because I beat a lot of his value hands, so was not too happy to see ace queen. And that was a hand that I lost half of my chips, and the very few hands, I think two hands later pretty much, I was in a big blind with 6-5, and small blind had queen 6, and the flop came queen deuce. So we both flopped 3 sixes, and the rest is history. My opponent check-raised the flop, and I called, and he bet the turn. I called, river he bet, and I raised, and the money was pretty much in. So I'm out. He had me covered a little bit. I'm going to rebuy right away. It's a really nice field, what we got so far on this 40k bounties. No reason that to take any big breaks here. So right away, back to the action. Just busted a hand, ace jack of spades against nines. All in pre for whatever, 300,000 pot. So my ace jack couldn't beat nines, so here we are again. Third bullet. Day one in the Mystery Bounty is finished. It was a long day. It's past 1 a.m. and we just finished playing. Good news is that I'm still in. Bad news is that I'm in for 3 bullets. A couple interesting hands. I end up playing quite a big pot versus Justin Bonomo earlier today. I raced with 7-9 of diamonds, and he 3-bet me from the position. And I decided to call because we were quite deep. And the flop came king-jack deuce with 2 diamonds. I check-called his bet on the flop. He bet around 25-30% of the pot. Turn was a perfect card for me. It came an ace of diamonds. So I made a flush on a turn, and I checked, and he decided to check behind, which actually saved me because the river came another diamond. We had quite a lot of money in the pot already. We had around 200,000, and I decided to bet 75,000 with my 9 high flush there, which was the 4th highest flush. And And he had a queen jack with the queen of diamond, and he only decided to call with second nut. So that kind of put me down with chips. But then a few rounds later, I had pocket eights, raised from the cutoff, and Chris Brewer, he shot from the bottom with ace jack. So I called, I had, you know, something like 20 big blinds. It's a standard hand, and I won that race with my eight. So anyways, the last few levels, I played on a TV table, and there was just one big hand that kind of ended up in an unfortunate way from my part, that Steve O'Dwyer, who opened from early position with 35,000. I had ace king offsuit from small blind. I made it 110,000. And Brin Kenny went on a tank on big blind and ended up shoving with 600,000 from the big blind. Easy call for me. Steve O'Dwyer folded, easy call for me. We got 1.2 million pot, ace king against ace queen, and actually river was a nine to make two pairs on the board, so we end up splitting the pot. So I guess splitting is better than losing the pot, but you know, he had only three outs to hit the queen to win the hand, so it was a not the best river, obviously. This is poker. I mean, happens all the time. So I have 460,000 now going for day two. If you look at how many players, we got 162 entries, 39 players left, 27 gets paid, and half of the prize pool goes to the bounty. So tomorrow when we start, the bounties also start. So bounties are worth a lot in this tournament. Anyways, let's see what happens tomorrow. Average is 830K, so my 460 is not looking so great. I don't know how many opportunities I'll have to knock some players out, but need to win some hands and just stay in a tournament, right?
This Noida with pocket jacks against Antonius is open off of ace jack.
This is exactly where he wants to be. Moving all in over the top of the min raise open from the fin. And that's a big chunk of this 410 back on request, but of course Patrik must make the call, especially with bounty considerations. Ace free flop and no diamond out there either. Not a great spot for Antonius. Jack's still best. All Noida needs to do is fade the ace, and he's done it.
There's three players under five big blinds. So people are gonna be ready to pounce.
Noida, small blind with the chips to do it, is going to seek to isolate Patrik. I mean, it's just 50K in front of Patrik. Maher doesn't want to let Spencer take a pull at that envelope by flatting.
Okay. I wasn't sure against
that. Patrick's going to try to claw back.
That makes me feel bad.
That much he lost.
I had a very, very bad hand. I had 9-5 off.
10-10-8, gut shot for Noida. He's facing a bit of a threat. Safe turn. Can Patrik find the triple and fade a 9? Yes, he can.
Yeah, he's in trouble against queens.
Antonius already having tripled, king-jack offsuit. Gets it in.
Well, we've seen Noida had the willingness, of course, to ISO the bounty, and here, but Chidwick gonna go for it, looking
that
for the tuffle a limb with a hand that is actually playing quite well up against the two other hands of his opponents.
Yeah, before you go scratching your temple, if you're just joining us, this is the kind of stuff we alluded to in the pregame show that you'll see on your screen that you wouldn't otherwise were it not for the fact that we're playing a mystery bounty. Chidwick's 8-9 suited. Looking for two envelopes as both Antonius and Noida now at risk. 1-5 into the muck already. The king-queen six board giving Antonius top pair. Comfortable lead for the time being. No sooner do I say the time being than the time changes. Upon the arrival of a deuce of hearts, Chidwick now a knock at the back door. Can he break hearts with a heart? No. Seven clubs on the end.
Six what?
Actually, it's just one club. It's the seven of clubs, but you know what I was getting at. Antonius gonna triple again. You know how like trumpet players do the circular breathing thing where they keep the trumpet by their mouth, play, never actually stop to take a breath? Something similar could be happening with Patrik where it's just a continuous chew. I believe in the bovine realm that cows will bring it back up, you know, like kind of swallow it, save it for later, run it back, chew it up some more, send it back down. Unclear. Oh, Noida looking for some clarification of his own here. And they're big adjustments. As we do see Mosbach ultimately fold, still wearing a sense of uncertainty on his face. 1 million plus in the middle. Noida and Antonius collide once more. Advantage Patrik until an ace shows up on the board. Patrik might be chewing a little bit harder than he was moments ago as he hunts a snowman, unavailable on the turn. Already tripling twice. Can he find the rabbit in the hat? No, a six on the end. And we're gonna need a to-go bag for the rest of that meal.
Unfortunately, my pocket ace couldn't win the race, so opponent flopped an ace, which held all the way, and here we are out again. So no bounties in this tournament, no cash. I fell, I think, 5-6 from the money, something around 27 got paid. And I have to say, I'm really not used to going five tournaments without cashes. Definitely claiming a bad run and a big downswing at this point of the High Roller Series. So that's it from Triton Monaco. It's been quite a tough run for me this time, but there's always other High Roller tournaments in the future. So. For sure, I'll be back on the final tables and wins at some point. Thank you everyone for watching. If you like my content, make sure you click the like and subscribe button so you can see what I'm doing in the future. And I'll see you at the next episode.